During the last months, liberal states have taken strict measures in order to stop the spreading of COVID-19. Many people argued that quarantine and government-mandated lockdowns infringe on their individual rights, namely to allow them to make their own choices, to express their own free will. Others went as far as to argue that liberalism has been resolved into totalitarianism. It may sound as an oxymoron, but in the first part of my paper, I will argue that these measures against individual liberty are compatible with the political philosophy of liberalism. To do so, I will go back to the traces of classic liberal thinkers. In the second part, I will try to answer an argument that is connected to the previous fallacy, the argument that the pandemic is somehow signaling the end of capitalism. Thomas Hobbes, arguably the father of liberalism, describes the state of nature as a war of all against all. It is a condition of continual fear and danger of violent death, where the life of man is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. According to Hobbes, people decide to shape into political communities in order to liberate themselves from the above dangers. Therefore, the main objective of government is protection of everybody's life. If that is the case, liberal states not only have the right to enforce anti-liberty measures, they have the moral obligation to do so. As long as these measures can stop the spreading of the disease, thus protecting people's life, then it is moral to impose them. John Locke further developed liberal political philosophy. He supported that the reason why people abandon the state of nature and organize political communities is to protect their life, liberty, and private property. He's less happy than Hobbes in taking anti-liberty or anti-private property measures, but he leaves us no doubts that life has a higher value than liberty or property. He goes as far as to remind us of the old Latin axiom, Salus populi suprema lex, people's health is the higher law of the state. Therefore, Locke would be ready to accept temporary limits of liberty in order to protect people's life. One could argue that mental health is part of the general concept of health, and mental health is violated in terrible ways under quarantine and social distancing laws. But we have to take into account the parameter of time. The measures are temporary. They are implemented in order to protect life, which leads us to another Latin axiom, primum vivere, deinde philosophare. That means our first duty is to live our lives and then to philosophize. If you are dead, you cannot have mental health or fruitful life. You're just dead. So we protect human life, even with these strong violations, in order for the people to survive and then to be able to regain their mental health. Let us now examine the perspective of a different type of moral philosophy. Immanuel Kant states that any individual who possesses reason is able to understand the meaning of moral law. Every person who possesses reason has a moral obligation to take responsibility for his actions. Kant holds that human beings, in order to act morally, have to be left free to choose their actions. They have to be left free to behave according to the moral law. The categorical imperative is the pivotal point of his philosophy. Act only according to that maxim, whereby you can, at the same time, will that it should become a universal law. If our lives were in danger, would we like other people to act in ways that protect our lives? If the answer is positive, then we have to do the same if other people's lives are in danger. In Kantian philosophy, every man or woman is an end to itself. We cannot use others as means to achieve goals. We cannot let thousands or millions of people to die in order to create herd immunity for others. If there is something that we can do that helps other people, we have to do it, even if that means building barricades against individual liberty. John Rawls follows the same philosophical path. He argues that we have to take moral and political decisions as if we were covered under a veil of ignorance. That is a very clever way to bypass the main problem of social contract theory. We have to deal with moral issues without taking into account our individual status, sex, color, social class, health, age, whatever. We have to decide as if we did not know our status. This maxim will lead us to objective moral decisions. If you are 20 years old, you might don't bother about COVID-19 because it affects mostly the elderly people. But if you wouldn't know your age or your health status, that would lead you to a more global perception of the pandemic. Therefore, in rules and moral philosophy, we are willing to accept the measures because everybody could be affected. John Stuart Mill supported utilitarianism, a different kind of moral theory. Utilitarianism deals with the consequences of an action. It argues that the government has to aim to the total happiness or utility of all the people. It has to secure the greatest good for the greatest number. It is very difficult for the utilitarian calculus to consider every possible parameter in an issue as complicated as COVID-19 pandemic. But in a way, it would be possible to argue that some people might be sacrificed for the greater benefit of others. It would be better to accept casualties in order to avoid greater risks in economy, because in the end, economic crisis will affect more lives. Well, this is a very slippery slope. One would argue that if we kill every person with HIV, then AIDS would be a thing of the past. We would sacrifice 2, 3, or 4% of our planet's population for the 96-97% of it to have a more pleasant and safer sexual life. I could produce many utilitarian arguments against this point, but I will leave it to the master himself. John Stuart Mill developed the harm principle. The actions of individuals should only be limited in order to prevent harm to others. Mill's On Liberty is a hymn on individual freedom. But even Mill is ready to accept that the only purpose for which power can be rightfully exercised over any member of a civilized community against his will is to prevent harm to others. This is a notion that goes back to the early days of French Revolution and the Declaration of the Rights of Man, the freedom to do everything which injures no one else. So, in Millian ethics and politics, the state can justfully impose limits in individual freedom if manifestation of this freedom could harm the lives of others. This is precisely the argument that makes illegal to drink alcohol and drive a motor car. By making drink and drive illegal, of course, we are setting limits to individual freedom. But we are doing so in order to protect other people's lives. Therefore, we can say that even in Millian ethics, temporary anti-liberty measures can be justified. So we find out that there's a strong liberal moral basis that supports state measures, but on the first hand, seem to be against liberal philosophy. Therefore, the argument that liberalism has been resolved into totalitarianism is not valid. Now, as for the pandemic signaling the end of capitalism. In 2008, many left-wing intellectuals declared that the economic crisis was a proof that Marx was finally right. In supporting this idea, they used an old rhetoric trick. They did not tell us precisely what Marx did say. It just left implications of it. But in order to understand if Marx was right or wrong, we first have to understand the precise context of the question, namely, in what sense Marx was right. If the Marxian argument was that in the future of capitalism we will see many crises, then of course the 2008 crisis could act as a paradigm. But Marx did not say that. Marx declared in 1848 that very soon capitalism will suffer a huge economic crisis. Then it will collapse and then socialism will follow. Did that happen in 2008? No. Did humanity get anywhere near this path after that? No. So Marx was not right. Marx was wrong. Similarly, many left-wing intellectuals view the COVID-19 pandemic as the catalyst that will fulfill their dream and finally destroy capitalism. They use similar rhetoric tricks. Take, for example, Judith Butler's paper, The Limits of Capitalism. The title suggestion comes as a solid conclusion, but in reality, it is no more than an empty tautology. Everything has limits. Even the universe has its limits. Only God does not have limits. So what's new then? The novelty that is cleverly implied here is that finally we have reached the limits of capitalism. This deadly virus exposed these limits. And now, after realizing that capitalism is finally mortal, we are ready to face its death. And what will happen afterwards? Most probably, socialism. I directly quote from the same paper, The proposition of universal and public health reinvigorated a socialist imaginary in the US. So the argument takes a tautology as a starting point, and then it implies an imaginary conclusion, a conclusion that cannot be produced or deduced by the argument's premises. Therefore, the conclusion is not valid. One part of this trick is the use of the term capitalism. By saying capitalism, neoliberalism, globalization, many postmodern intellectuals mean everything that they do not like. Especially with the first word, capitalism, they use it as somehow it means precisely the same thing today as it meant in 1780 or 1871. In the broad sense, capitalism means a socio-political system where the means of production are in private hands. Under the light of this perspective, nothing has changed since then. But again, under this perspective, capitalism is now stronger than ever. How many countries were capitalist countries in 1780 or in 1871 or in 1968? And how many now in 2020? So, if we accept this basic definition, then discussing about the limits or the coming death of a system that is ever expanding is nonsense. But there are a million different things attributed to capitalism. So when they use the word, they imply these different meanings: inequality, injustice, absence of welfare state. But here lies another aspect of the rhetoric trick technique. First of all, inequality and injustice are not the property of capitalism. They characterize mankind for the last 3,000 years, with very, very brief exceptions, like the Greek polis that gave birth to democracy, that was the standard of living everywhere. Secondly, we have to realize that unrestrained capitalism, as Karl Popper used to describe it, was the primitive, wild version of free liberal economy. It was the model that Marx studied and wrote about. But this specific version of capitalism passed away soon after Marx's death. Marx saw capitalism as a non-elastic, unchangeable system. He was wrong again. Capitalism proved to be an elastic system that can adapt millions of changes. It cannot eliminate inequality and poverty, but it can absorb the shocks by putting limits in inequality and poverty. Basically, this is the argument behind welfare state, which of course is not a socialist invention, as Judith Butler implies. Welfare state is not a socialist measure, it is a liberal measure. Socialism wants to abolish capitalism, not to take advantage of it. Marx was perfectly clear in that. In the early 20th century, welfare system was seen as the clever capitalist weapon that neutralizes the revolutionary wills of the working class. A barrier of hypocrisy against the coming of the Red Revolution. It may act in that way. I would not argue against that. But to this point, we shall add two propositions. First, let us not forget that, as I said earlier, the concept of welfare state is a liberal concept. Liberal philosophers, John Locke or John Stuart Mill among them, believe that the state has certain obligations to the citizens. Locke argues that the reason behind the creation of the state is protection of life, liberty, and private property. The welfare system supports the right of the poor people to a safe life. Of course, the working class movement played a great role in forcing the state to accept this position. But again, this position is a liberal, not a socialist position. Actually, this particular policy ensured the long-livedness of capitalism, which leads us to the second proposition. Regardless of the motive that triggered the welfare system, the result is beneficiary for millions of people. Capitalism is stronger now than ever. That does not mean that capitalism is benevolent or that by observing reality one takes stands in favor of capitalism. It only means that closing our eyes to reality is absurd. There are signs that pandemic could possibly lead to setting limits on globalization, but that does not signify the end of capitalism. It might be connected with just another transformation of the system. John Maynard Keynes is linked to the welfare state idea. American New Deal, European Social Democrat policies followed his path. But Keynes was not a socialist. He was liberal to the core. Along with Friedrich Hayek, they formed the poles of liberalism, not the socialist and liberal pole. So it is now possible that we will see a move towards more Keynesian policies, the return of the nation state. That could be interesting, but that is not socialism. Practically, it is even more dangerous to socialism, because so-called neoliberal economy gives an easy target to egalitarian arguments, because a more social democrat economy, a more center-left economy, leaves little room for that kind of arguments. In one celebrated passage, Marx argued that philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways, but the point is to change it. He is right into that. But in order to change it, or even try to change it, we first have to understand the world. It is sad, but many of his followers are so much preoccupied with the idea that the world of capitalism is dying that they cannot understand it. And this is sad precisely because understanding the world should always be the first step of any attempt to change it, at least if we want to change it for a better one. Thank you very much for listening.